that. So let's just talk about this crisis. And first, and maybe we can talk a little bit about your how you define these gender versus sex with this debate.
Okay, so starting with the statistics. So what we call the boy crisis. Okay, so I back when I did The Wonder of Boys, so back 30 years ago, we already could see it. And so I have in even in that book 30 years ago, I have it in there, you know, okay, better look at these stats. Look what's happening. And it was never, it's another anti-female or anything like that. I mean, you know, we're an equity, we're equity culture. So we have the resources to help everyone. So to me, it was never zero sum. It was never a debate against someone else. It was just, hey, look, already the boys were way behind in college, you know, way behind in education. This is 30 years ago, you know, on and on and on. And now it's just gotten worse. I mean, now the suicide statistics, the fentanyl, you know, so addictive disorder statistics, the brain disorder statistics, ASD, ADHD, you know, it's looking really, really grim. And then we have the boys who just can't develop, they can't mature. And I'll talk about it. I'm sure today we'll talk about kind of our abandonment of healthy male development in the West. And for all those political reasons that we did that 50 years ago, but you know, we got to rethink it and on and on and on. And there's no statistical area where we won't go, oh my gosh, look what's happening to these guys. Now that doesn't mean that women don't struggle. I mean, COVID, post-COVID, you've got a lot of overt depression, you know, among girls and women that followed through there, and anxiety, you know, social anxiety disorder. I mean, we have a lot for girls and women. So again, not a zero sum. For males, we have a lot of covert depression and the disease of violence. And then that shows up in addictive disorder, suicide, fentanyl, and withdrawal. And one of the, we talk about diseases of loneliness, you know, everyone will have heard these terms, diseases of despair. A lot of that is simply male. You know, I mean, there are just more males right now dying of those diseases across the lifespan. So we want to start out by saying we're going to talk about boys because that's our subject, but it doesn't in any way downplay the struggles of girls and women. It's just that we got to get people to see what's going on with boys and men, because it's really good for girls and women to have healthy boys and men. And it's not good for girls and women to have unhealthy boys and men, right? We're all interconnected. So, and especially as people mature and they want to marry and, you know, have kids and all of that, we got to have mature, healthy boys and men. So not just for themselves, but for everyone else.
Absolutely. And I really like this quote from one of your books. I've read multiple books of yours, so I'm pulling stuff from everywhere here, Mike. But you say ensuring gender equality for girls and women does not require gender sameness. And Right. What you really highlight, especially in one of like the first book I read of yours, which was Boys and Girls Learn Differently.
Oh, yeah.
You should see how marked up this book is. It's insane.
I love it.
I was a teacher before I became a psychologist. And so I was in a kindergarten classroom, third grade. And I'm telling you, those are two different creatures, my boys and my girls, and how they learned and moved. And I never understood why. And now I'm a mom of a boy, and well, I'm married to a boy. And I notice these differences. And, you know, it's not just social. Can you talk about a little bit, touch on the brain science a little bit? Like, I have tons of notes here, but like, you're the expert.
Yeah. So sexual dimorphism is a very real thing. So sexual dimorphism, I know if you look at social media, you sometimes find people going, no, there's no such thing as sexual, you know, because there's a whole bunch of politics around this. But in real life, sexual dimorphism is a real thing. So all the way back in the late 80s, I was starting to use brain scans to show people how differently the male and the female brain operated. And
you're talking, I think everyone, we're talking chromosomal, like XY.
XXXY.
XX. So we're really talking about sex differences. I always differentiate gender and sex. And so really what Mike's talking about are sex differences based on hormonal changes and the chromosomal makeup, right? Like that's what we're mostly talking about here.
Yeah. Starting in the 70s, it happened where everything switched to gender. And it was easier for the Supreme Court that was trying a case in the 70s with Ruth Bader Ginsburg. It was just easier for academics, for everyone to just say gender. Then it was easier for the media, right? And so sex, because sex was associated with reproduction and the Sex Act, everything switched to gender. But gender is a social construct. And I know we'll talk about gender nonconforming and gender fluidity in this talk. Gender is a social construct, right? It's not sex. Sex is what comes in on the X and the Y. So XX is female, XY is male. The Y chromosome triggers the mom who's carrying the baby. It triggers that little bit of androgenic hormone to go into the womb. And then that stimulates the testes to drop. And while the testes are dropping in that, you know, that sort of 4 to 5 month period testosterone's flooding the male system and it's not flooding the female. So that little baby boy is getting flooded with 10 to 20 times the amount of testosterone. And that will be true through the lifespan. Males get 10 to 20 times the amount of testosterone. That is a very, very powerful chemical. It differentiates the male brain from the female brain. So now there's 4 billion people on Earth, right? Or I'm sorry, there's 8 billion people on Earth. So there's 4 billion ways to be boy, 4 billion ways to be girl. That's true, no doubt. But the 4 billion ways to be boy are on the boy brain. And the 4 billion ways to be girl are on the girl brain because of the sex differentiation in utero. So by 6 months in utero, the baby, the fetus, has become now immune to the cross-sex hormone. So now that brain is formed. And we, in fact, have, and I'll talk about what formed means because there's great variety, but the brain is formed. And as of 2019, fMRIs were used on fetuses. And already at 8 months in utero, the scientists can see that that's a male brain, that's a female brain. So they can tell it in utero. So the concept, so then gender. So the concept that was popular, especially in academia, what I call the big three, academics moves into government and media. That's kind of the big three. So when something happens in academia, then it moves through government and media. And the thing that happened in academia is the decision was made for sameness, right? Because we were all of us in academics, right? I go back 50 years. We were good feminists, right? And everyone was like, okay, come on, you know, we're going to have gender equality. But the mistake that was made is that gender sameness got built in. So to have equality, everyone had to be the same. That was incorrect. It still defies the science. We all want equality and we'll get it. And women have come a huge way, but we're not the same. The 4 billion boys and the men and the 4 billion girls, women, their brains are set up differently. And if you want me to, I can give some obvious differences that everyone will recognize. And because of that, our systems need to understand boys and girls from the brain level. So nature, nurture, and culture all matter, but we got to start with nature or our systems will not serve boys or girls, women or men. Now, 50 years ago, we made the change for women. We said, okay, that female brain is different. Women are different. We need to understand their assets and we need to uplift their assets and alter all our systems to understand their assets. Those were female assets. Back then, it was female assets. Girls and women were female. And the female assets we had to uplift and understand. It gradually moved, though, into gender stuff, which is social construct. And so I think we still do understand that females bring assets that we need to, you know, we need to use. Like when we try to get women to move up in corporations, we're saying we want those women. Like they're not a gender, they're women, and we need their assets. We're not doing that for boys and men, though. With boys and men, we're saying there is no male brain. We don't want to deal with that. Mm-hmm. And so that's a mistake because now we've got systems from all across the board, systems to develop them social, emotionally, counselor systems, education systems, governmental systems. You know, everywhere we have systems that have been created that do not understand that these guys are male. So we're just losing them by the millions.
I think so. And what was really helpful to me, and especially as an educator and who worked with young boys and then as a mom and now a wife, you know, trying to understand the boys in my life better. One of the things I looked at that really spoke to me was kind of like the differences in how men process information. It's completely different where they spend time at rest within their brain, mm-hmm. like the limbic system versus the brain stem. I think we can maybe talk about that.
Yeah, we can talk about it. Yep.
And even how women process information faster, how they handle pain versus men move towards pain. Like this stuff is like mind-blowing. And if you want to connect with a boy, you need to listen to Michael here and he will explain this stuff to you. And if you're a teacher, how to accommodate these structural differences into your teaching style.
Yeah, it matters to all systems, counselor systems, education systems. Okay, so let me give, you just cut me off when you want, but I'll just do a few minutes on the brain differences so people can understand how significant this is.
Yes.
So women, I'm going to jump off some of what you said. So girls and women, so the female brain has word centers on both sides of the brain, multiple word centers on both sides of the brain. Male brains, oh, and we should mention these are because they come in on XXXY, right? Even if you're XXXYY, right? My brain just glitched. YXXY, intersex. Yeah. I glitched for a sec. Even if you're, you know, the exception, intersex, your brain will still lean one way or the other toward male or female. And even with all the variety, when your brain is scanned, you'll see these differences. So girls and women on both sides of the brain, word centers, and very importantly, those word centers on both sides of the brain connect to the midbrain where senses, memory, and emotion, right, are happening. So the female brain tends to move emotive material up very quickly, up to the top, which is where the word centers are. Not coincidentally, the female brain uses the frontal lobe, which is executive decision-making, impulse control, word production, word use, emotive processing, et cetera. About 80% of the time, she's in her frontal. Okay, so if she's sitting in a chair and she's looking at a book, 80% of her white matter and gray matter activity are happening in the frontal. Okay, males, he's sitting in the chair looking at a book or something. He could have zero white matter in the frontal and only 40% gray matter, where she's got 80%. So the huge gap, not only in word production and the ability to connect feelings, memories, et cetera, to words, but also the fact that she's operating there in the frontal. So she's already defaulting toward impulse control, you know, executive function, emotive processing, et cetera. Okay. So then you add on the white matter, gray matter activity difference. The female brain uses about 10 times more white matter activity than the male. White matter is all through the myelin and it connects the dots. So it means that her brain is connecting 20 or 30 things at once using white matter activity.
It's like telephone wires, right? So it's like processing speed is higher. Is that how you describe as telephone wires of the brain, the white matter?
Yeah. Like they're going everywhere. She's just picking it up from everywhere. And he could have fast processing as long as it's happening in the gray matter areas that he has dominated. You're right, that are dominating him. Males use up to 7 times more gray matter activity. So gray matter is in splotches in the brain. It doesn't spread the signaling everywhere. Now, men have white matter activity, women have gray matter activity, of course. But this is a profound difference because it means, to give an example to somebody, whether you're a couple, let's go with a heterosexual couple for now, so we have a male female, whether you have a male client in your counseling practice, whether you have a boy in your classroom, it's crucial we know this because when she is asked a question, you know, how do you feel about that or something like that, anything that has to do with social emotional, her brain is going to be able to almost immediately process an answer. But his brain, right, not as much in the frontal, not as many word centers, not as much connectivity, operating out of gray matter areas, some of which may have no emotive connectivity, he is going to take 12 hours, 24 hours. You know, he can take much longer. So we call it the male delayed reaction because his brain is not dominated by white matter activity that processes the stuff, is not dominated by frontal lobe activity. He's operating further back with less of that. So...